Hello and welcome to the Agenda MRJ call. In this program today we will talk about the upcoming FATF meet to review Pakistan's actions on ending state support to terror. It happens every time ahead of the meeting of Financial Action Task Force or FATF to review the case of Pakistan in terms of actions to end support to terrorism. The Pakistan government is bringing new laws on forfeiture of properties related to money laundering and transfer of such investigations to specialized entities. Will these moves meet the benchmark set by the FATF for removing Pakistan from the grey list? We will deliberate on this issue in the agenda today. We have with us retired Major General Ashwani Siwaj, Mr. Jitendra Kumar Oja, geopolitical expert, and from Pakistan, we are joined by political analyst Tamseel Ahmed. But before we start our conversation, have a look at this small report.
Financial Task Force or FATF, which is a global watchdog on terror financing and money laundering, had asked Pakistan to fulfill 27 actions to demonstrate end of state support to terrorism. Carrying out this action is necessary for Pakistan to get out of the FATF grey list, under which a country is kept under close scrutiny regarding the terror activities. Pakistan has been in this list since 2018. By February, Pakistan had carried out 24 of the actions and FATF had asked it to carry out the remaining actions, failing which the country could be placed in the blacklist. It will mean that Pakistan will not be able to receive aid from international financial organizations like World Bank, International Monetary Fund and Asian Development Bank. The FATF will be holding plenary meetings on June 21st to review Pakistan's actions. This has put the Pakistani state in a tight spot since it wants to avoid being blacklisted, but at the same time its dubious policy does not allow it to end support to terrorism, which it uses as an extended arm to hurt other countries, especially India and Afghanistan. Accordingly, it has been carrying out half-hearted actions intended to fool the 39-member FATF. The latest one is the move to bring new laws on forfeiture, management and auction of properties and assets relating to anti-money laundering cases and transfer of investigation and prosecution of such cases to specialized entities from police, provincial, anti-corruption and similar agencies. Pakistani media had reported that the cabinet of Prime Minister Imran Khan has approved these new rules as part of the measures mandated by the FATF. It now remains to be seen whether the FATF is convinced by this action of Pakistan, which has been making attempts to hoodwink the global grouping for the last 3 years. Bureau Report.
Now let's welcome our guests, Major General Siwaj, Mr. Oja and Tamseel Ahmed from Pakistan. Welcome to the program, all of you. So I'll first go to Tamseel about the laws that the Pakistan government apparently is bringing on this money laundering issue. Can you brief us on that?
Thank you very much, Mr. Azim. Thank you very much for letting me the chance to discuss and talk about this matter. Well, there are certain things, but many things are still not disclosed by the government, that what they are bringing in this upcoming law to stop this money laundering.
Yeah.
But before this law came into being and it is implemented, we had to look in the intention of the government of Pakistan, whether Mr. Imran Khan, he actually wants to address this issue, or again he is just trying to play a political point scoring against his political opponents. Because as far as his last 3 years' performance is concerned, all of his acts and all of his actions are just targeting his political opponents. He did not take any concrete step, any concrete thing that could actually address the issue that Pakistan is facing currently. I still doubt, whatever the law will be coming, whether he will be taking the people under consideration according to that law across the board, or again, there will be a pick and choose. Because personally, and everybody knows that, from our side, Mr. Imran Khan, he is a very right-inclined person, and the people who we consider are the terrorists. In the past, we have seen that Imran Khan always spoke in their favor. So I doubt his intention. Unless and until this thing is properly on the table and with the proper legislation.
So are you, Tamsil Ahmed, trying to say that it is a farcical action, or maybe Imran Khan is trying to play to the gallery, or what is, I mean, why are you doubting his intentions?
Yes, because I doubt the intentions of Mr. Imran Khan. Because, you know, when the government was serious, because this is a serious thing, the terrorism, this is something which I always speak that Pakistan has suffered a lot.
Right.
As compared to any country in the world. So if the will is there, we have seen in the past, when there was the Pakistan People's Party government from 2008 to 2013, you might be aware of that they launched military operations in different districts and cities of Pakistan. Our Nagin area, our Swat Valley, that was completely under control of these terrorists. The political will was there, the will of the government was there, they did an operation and the area was cleaned by these terrorist people. But now, since 3 years, we haven't seen any concrete step taken that has been taken or that has been taken by Mr. Imran Khan. So I still doubt that whether he really wants to address this issue or not. Because 6 months back, on this FATF issue, they were again playing the political card against opponents. This is the time you have to sit with all the parties,
right,
all the stakeholders to eradicate this thing. But I don't think so he's willing to do that.
Okay. So, Major General Siwaj, you heard Mr. Tamsil Ahmed from Pakistan, what he is saying, that Imran Khan's intentions may not be as genuine as he tries to put. Maybe he is trying to target the political opponents. What do you say on this?
Absolutely correct. He has hit the nail on the head. The fact is, as far as Pakistan is concerned, they are not very serious in taking action against the terrorists and money laundering and terrorist funding. They have failed time and again. In fact, Pakistan deserves to be downgraded from grey to blacklist. And this is a normal practice of Pakistan just before the financial act meeting, which is take place a month or 2 months earlier than that. They start showing to the world that they are taking action against the terrorist organizations like Lashkar-e Toba, Jaish-e Mohammed, Taliban or Haqqani group. But this is all false. They are not serious in taking any action, and the moment financial action task force meeting is over, the business become as usual as it was earlier. You see, the Pakistan must understand that they keep on telling to the whole world that they are victim of terrorism themselves. On first place, who created this terrorism? It is you who created the terrorism for the whole world. You are the one which are sending Lashkar-e Toba, Jaish-e Mohammed terrorists in India, and Haqqani group and Taliban in Pakistan, and Sunni militants in Iran, and the Tariq-e-Taliban Pakistan, which is creating problem for you, is been created by Pakistan itself. So, till you do not differentiate, till you stop differentiating between the bad terrorists and good terrorists, you will find that you will never able to handle the terrorism sincerely. It is the eyewash, the Pakistan is not taking any sincere steps. And today it looks like today,
yeah,
the way things are going in Pakistan today, they are on a brink of a financial crisis. They have $115 billion as a debt, for which they require $4 billion per year to pay the only the interest. The inflation rate is almost 20%. The foreign reserve is only about $10 to $12 billion, less than even Afghanistan. Cannot look after 1 month of their import. In such a critical situation, if they think they can hoodwink financial task force, they are totally wrong.
I agree on one issue, that they may not be downgraded into a blacklist by virtue of by the number game, because the Financial Action Task Force plays in a matter of numbers,
right.
And they have a few friends in Malaysia, Turkey and China, which will hold their hand, and they may not be downgraded because minimum 3 votes are required. But so it be, can they come out on the grey list into white? They need 13 countries, which they will never get it, considering their track record. In fact, the track record dictates the Pakistan must be downgraded from grey to black list to teach the Pakistan lesson, to ensure that they stop terrorist funding and money laundering.
Yes. So, I go to Mr. Oja. You heard the other panelists, and as you, as Major General Shivas said about good terrorists and bad terrorists. I think that is the problem that Pakistan has been in, because, I mean, one terrorist is good, one terrorist is bad. What do you say? I mean, that has the been the main problem.
I think problem is much deeper than that, Ajayji. And I'll take just a few minutes to explain it, because Pakistan was created to fulfill strategic objectives of Western colonial powers when they were receding from this part of the world. And unfortunately, a new narrative of hatred towards Hindu was created, and you know, all kinds of crime, all kinds of perversity was generated. Islam had developed a highly humanist face on this subcontinent, which we know as our Sufi culture, highly egalitarian. All these things were destroyed because colonial powers wanted some people to do it, and you know, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, he was a Gujarati Baniya, known as a person of integrity in any way. He had nothing to do with Islam or any of its values. Since then, this has happened. There was no one. So, whom are they trying to fool? It is, we feel sorry for people of Pakistan, because a very criminalized syndicate is ruling Pakistan, and it is ruling for itself. Sometimes it is acting as comprador of West, now it is acting as comprador of China. It is very convenient for people, you know, to use terrorism through a proxy named Pakistan or its elite. I wouldn't say Pakistan, I would say a small caucus. And to see the
regime, the regime there.
Yeah, the regime over there, not a regime, a very clandestine syndicate. Imran Khan is a puppet of that syndicate. Entire terror infrastructure is just a hogwash. It is being created to do what? Run organized crime network. To ensure that no voice of sanity is allowed in that country. There are fairly decent people, I'm not saying they're fairly educated, decent people. After all, they're part of us only. They are part of our converts only. They are there. But, you know, the whole thing has been taken to a different level, because this syndicate wants to run organized crime network, retain its predominance in that area, would never allow democratic civilian setup to come up over there. At the same time, it has been fulfilling objectives of A, B, D and other powers. And the whole thing is what? Create a massive infrastructure of terror. You see the kind of propaganda they are carrying out. Do you think for next 50 years or 100 years, average Pakistanis are going to be able to live with non-Muslims anywhere in the world? You take the case of terrorism, whether it is in Europe or in Far East or whether in Africa or anywhere, whether it's organized crime or terror, Pakistani hand is there. And who's involved in that? Pakistan military is involved in it. And Imran Khan is a puppet of that. It is very unfortunate and very shameful that some of the global leaders like Erdogan or others, or even Xi Jinping and others, they think if Pakistan is a very faithful proxy, or I don't want to use another word, for my deference, you know, people, some decent people over there. So, you know, there is not going to be anything at all. Let us be assured, they are just trying to fool this thing. If Pakistan is really sincere, it has to carry out restructuring of its all institutions and see that there is a civilian government. See that there are courts are autonomous. You see, a few months back, this Daniel Pearl's killer, where Al-Qaeda, this thing was released. Do you think even if they bring laws, these laws are going to be implemented in any way? Nothing is going to happen. They just want to see that people of Pakistan somehow, you know, the problems are kept at a minimum threshold or manageable level. At the same time, they want to use impoverished young people of that country as a kind of human bomb who can be just used. Will any of the military generals like to make their own children as the suicide bombers? They will never like to do that. Will these mullahs who are their proxies or their, what should I say, will they like to use their children as bombs or terrorists anywhere? They would never like to do that. So if Pakistan is suffering, it is because of boomerang impact of a criminalized elite that is ruling Pakistan. And Pakistani people should realize that, you know, by hating Hindus, by spitting venom against Hindu, you're not going to achieve anything, because your forefathers were also Hindus, whether in Arab or whether in Central Asia or whether on the subcontinent. Try to be a good human first, and that is the first objective of the teachings of Islam. And Islam does not teach that you become a killer, marauder, or bomber, and looter, and a rapist, and you cover everything, you blame everything in the name of your holy prophet. So I think Pakistan is the biggest shame as far as a state, I'm saying, I'm not saying all the people, the biggest shame on this planet. And I hope some sane people in Pakistan, they come up. There's no point, you know, thriving on this hatred against Hindus or India, because they have to mind their own life. And if they don't do it, they realize what kind of price they have paid themselves.
Pakistan role in terrorism, supporting terrorism, and FATF meeting which is coming up. Tamseel, I go back to you, come back to you. As you heard Mr. Oja also saying about a syndicate, how much do you agree with that? There is a syndicate which has actually, and in whose clutches entire Pakistan is, and Pakistan is suffering. What do you say on that syndicate? Perhaps he is referring to the army, and clearly he is referring to army and intelligence agencies. What do you say?
Can you repeat the question?
My question is that Mr. Oja was referring to a syndicate which has, whose clutches entire Pakistan is, and Pakistan is suffering. So apparently he is referring to the Pakistan army and intelligence
and
agencies,
organized global criminals,
and who are actually holding, entire Pakistan hostage, and Pakistan is suffering because of that. What do you say?
Let me very realistic. First of all, I heard something from your guest side also. But what I believe in, when we are addressing this serious kind of thing, that is terrorism, and that is affecting the whole world, we have to be very realistic. We have to accept our mistakes, and rather than pointing out the issues on the other side. Okay, whatever the concern from your guest has been raised, let me tell you, as I told before that, this is a mere, you can say, a blame. But, as I told you, when the political governments over here, they wanted to address this issue, they did take the steps, and it was eradicated. The areas which the political parties, the political government of Pakistan, they wanted to cleanse, they did that. It is not just that army, it is not just that Pakistan army is playing all the cards, it is not just that Pakistan army is making all the laws, or playing with all the laws. It is not like that. Again, it's a main game that will continue from the both sides. Well, I will have a lot of things to...
Tamseel,
the same, I will get the response. But will that solve the problem?
No, Tamseel. Okay, let us not go to the blame game. Let us not go to the blame game. Let us talk about reality. The reality is that army does not allow any civilian government in Pakistan to complete its term. Has any civilian government completed its term in Pakistan? Now, talk about Nawaz Sharif. He tried to make good relations with India twice. In 1999 also, and now recently also. Then what has happened to him? The army and intelligence agencies got after him, and he is now in exile. So let us face it, that is the reality. The army and intelligence agencies don't allow any civilian government to function. That is the problem.
It is not like that.
He can't speak. Ajay ji, you want him to speak? If he speaks, tomorrow he will be knocked out by army. So don't pressure him.
I know, but yeah. Whatever he can speak, you can speak. Yeah, please.
Let me complete. See, we have seen that the good relation time between India and Pakistan was during Musharraf's tenure. Can you disagree with that? Can you disagree that how warmly he was welcomed in India when he was holding his all of official positions in Pakistan? It is not just that civilian governments want to shake hands or want to have a green channel with India. Our other military governments have done the same. Recently, if you go back just a month or 1.5 months back, the very first message for the peace talks between India and Pakistan was by Chief of Army Staff from Pakistan. So it is not that army don't want complete or positive relations between us, but the issue that is making the obstacle that need to be addressed. And as I have said many times before, that cannot be solved in our talk shows, in our debates. That will be solved on a proper table talk.
Okay. So, we have to conclude. Maybe two quick questions to General Siwaj. You heard Tamseel, and maybe what is your comment before?
Ajay, I could not hear him very clearly, but certainly
no. I'll tell you, he was saying that it's not only civilian governments which want good relations with India, even military rulers like General Musharraf also tried to make good relations with India, although it was after the Kargil war and other things. What do you say? That's what he's right.
No, not at all. You see, the problem in Pakistan is that the Pakistan army and Pakistan intelligence.
We have only general. We have only 1 minute to conclude. So please,
So the issue today is that the Pakistan army does not want good relations with India. There is no doubt. They want to remain in the forefront. And the only reason of their staying in forefront is if they have a continuous enmity with India. You know, that is the only where it makes the Pakistan army important in Pakistan country.
Right.
As far as Pakistan is concerned, remember that whatever you may do, Pakistan army will not let the relationship grow. The moment a civil government will try to do, the civil government is thrown out. And today what they are doing is, they are enjoying the fruit of governing the country without any responsibility.
Accountability,
that is the trick which they have now started recently.
So I'll go to Mr. Oja, brief comment before we conclude.
The Pakistan army has to be defanged. They are perpetually at war with India. They think that, you know, they can use deception, they can use the Kaya, they can use everything to continue with a kind of clandestine war through criminal syndicates, through organized crime. And Pakistan army itself is involved in drug trade and, you know, money laundering and a variety of crimes. And I'm not saying it now. All global agencies have said they have managed to bring pressure on FATF, but that is not going to, you know, to what extent FATF succeeds in raining down Pakistan, we don't know. But expecting Pakistan to change is like wishful thinking. This is not going to happen in foreseeable future, Ajay.
Yeah, you talked about defanging of Pakistan army. I don't know who will defend. They will not defend themselves.
India will have to do it. India will have to do it.
One thing more
with the help of people of Pakistan.
Yeah.
With help of people of Pakistan, ordinary people of Pakistan.
They are running a parallel government. They are having a trade and business of $62 billion.
No, they are the government, not parallel government. They are the government there.
They are 4G Foundation and having a trade of $62 billion. That is the type of parallel economy will they run. How will a central government be able to function when the Pakistan army is involved from Alpha to Zulu in everything? Civil administration, in importing, in exporting. The irony today is Pakistan army is a part of a problem, not a part of a future.
Right. You are right that Pakistan army has to be, I mean, it's a main problem there, but I know Tamzil Ahmed can't say this.
Let us
but
hope
this is all the time we have.
Of India can unite by such sentiments.
Yeah, we have all the time in this program today. Thank you all of you for participating in this debate today.
Thank you.
This is all in the agenda today. Thanks for watching. I'll be back with another important topic tomorrow. Till then, goodbye.